Good afternoon. As an emerging technologies strategist, I am often asked to peer into the crystal ball of innovation. And whenever I am, I always try to bear in mind the sage advice of that great American philosopher, Yogi Berra, who nailed it when he said, "Making predictions is very hard, especially about the future." Nevertheless, we're likely to see more change in the next decade than we've seen in the last century. So, join me. Let's dive into this unpredictable adventure. And I'll start by asking you to please join me on a short trip to the near future. It's a hot day in Lansing, Michigan, a hot summer day, 101 degrees. But that's nothing compared to what's forecast, temperatures in excess of 105 every day for at least the next week. So the HVAC systems cooling the state office building are running full tilt. When suddenly an Internet of Things sensor embedded in the primary blower motor, pushing that cool air through the state office building, detects that it has reached an excessive degree of wear, despite the fact that scheduled maintenance isn't due for another couple of months. The demands of climate change have taken a toll on this equipment, and it's about to go out. It's got a day or two of service left at best. It needs to be replaced immediately. So, let me ask you, hands, what do you do? Who's got a suggestion? Yes, sir, over here.
Contact the primary
HVAC vendor. Absolutely, excellent idea. And so we do that. And they say, "Oh my gosh, you didn't have scheduled maintenance coming up for another couple of months. We planned on having that part in there a couple weeks beforehand just to be sure, but we don't have it. Don't have anything compatible. Can't get it anytime soon. Can't be of any help to you. I'm sorry." So now what do we do? Who's got a suggestion as far as the next step you might come up with? Yes, sir. Go home and work from home. Well, that may be what you'd have to do if you went back into the past, say like back in 2023, there's a good chance you'd have to just shut the building down, send the employees home at great expense to the state and inconvenience both to the employees and to the constituents who come into the state office building to do business. But fortunately, that's no longer the case. What happens instead is that the state's automated infrastructure maintenance system, immediately on detection of the problem, launches an intelligent procurement agent onto the internet, searching not only throughout the Lansing, greater Lansing area, and across the state of Michigan, but in fact across the entire country, for current or new providers of HVAC maintenance parts and services that can provide us this critical part and get it delivered by tomorrow morning. It asks each of them to provide a blockchain-based non-fungible token certifying their corporate financials, the sustainability of their business operations so that they can do business with the state of Michigan, and the availability and quality and functionality of the part that they have available that they propose to provide. And then also asks them to confirm when and how they can ship that part overnight and the pricing terms and conditions. After having identified several of those, it evaluates those proposals, selects the first one, the best one, which happens to be a new vendor that the state hasn't done business with before previously. So it sets them up as a vendor in the state's procurement system and in the state's accounts payable system, and issues a blockchain-based smart contract confirming the product to be shipped and the pricing terms and conditions for the procurement of that particular piece. It also reaches out and schedules a qualified maintenance technician to be on site and available when the product arrives the next morning. When she gets there the next morning, the product comes in, and she realizes that although she has installed hundreds of blower motors before, she never happens to have installed this particular brand of blower motor on this specific type of HVAC system. Fortunately, it comes with instructions. So she simply slips on her augmented reality goggles, and it projects step-by-step instructions directly onto the blower motor and the adjacent parts of the HVAC system into which it needs to be installed. She completes the installation on a timely basis, and despite the excessive temperatures outdoors, the state office building remains cool and comfortable for state employees and visiting constituents alike. Now, what are some of the kind of technologies we've touched on in this particular scenario that would enable this kind of story to actually take place at some point in the near future? Anybody?
Blockchain,
that's one of them, right? What else? Yes, sir.
Augmented reality.
Augmented reality, very good. There's a couple more. Back in the back, somebody's raising their hand. Yes, ma'am? Sir, sorry? Well, NFTs, which is a function of blockchain technology, all right?
Smart agents.
Smart agents, which is a subset of what kind of technology?
AI.
Of AI, right. And one more thing I don't think we mentioned quite yet.
IoT,
Internet of Things. All of these are examples of emerging technologies in various degrees of maturity, but as they emerge and come together, they enable functionality and capabilities far beyond what we are able to do just today. Now, IoT can be exciting because it has a host of different applications. For example, we're beginning to see smart vehicle to infrastructure communications where intelligent infrastructure monitoring highways, intersections, and so forth is able to communicate with smart cars. In this case, communicating with a car prior to its making a turn on its planned route, that a pedestrian that's not yet within the car's field of view is crossing the street outside of the crosswalk, and as a result, the driver of the car is able to step on the brake just in time to avoid killing doofus. Virtual reality and augmented reality. But virtual reality is increasingly being used to provide safe and realistic environments for training first responders. It's already shown to improve response times, situational awareness, and decision-making skills. In Elk Grove, California, they've been using virtual reality for 5 or 6 years now. We don't want to have to burn down a building every time we are trying to train firefighters in the best techniques for putting out fires, much less, and more importantly, risk the lives and health of the firefighters themselves. So with virtual reality, they're able to have the experience. And in the case of the city of Austin, Texas, they are now using ambulance buses for mass disaster response. So that rather than sending a traditional ambulance that has perhaps two gurneys in it, the ambulance bus has a dozen or more gurneys in it. Now the problem is they only have one of these in Austin. They only have a dozen in the whole state of Texas. So they don't want to make it unavailable for response if needed by taking it out of service to train responders in how to use it. So what they did was they developed a virtual reality simulation that allows people to put on the goggles and the gloves and feel just as if they are actually inside the AMBUS, walking up and down the main aisle, identifying where do we find these medications? Where do they keep these specific fluids that might be needed? Where are these bandages and wraps of various types? This fellow's being very smart. He's walking in a hallway, long and narrow, just like the AMBUS. That way, even though they've never been on it before, rather than waste valuable time trying to figure out what is where on the AMBUS, they're able to much more quickly respond to the needs of those patients in providing them services in the case of a mass disaster that requires it. When I first started seriously investigating AI back in the 1980s, I remember reading a paper by one of the leading thinkers in the field at the time, who projected that someday we would have artificial intelligence so advanced that you would be able to speak to a computer and it would understand your words and transcribe them into written text. Can you imagine such a thing? Well, a lot of people say, well, that's not artificial intelligence, that's just speech recognition. Well, just speech recognition still requires a lot of intelligence. 40 years ago, that would have been considered just miraculous. Because we've had it around for a few years now, we're used to the idea, so we don't think it's anything special. But it's a type and one of many different kinds of AI. Natural language processing, robotic process automation to automate routine clerical and operational tasks of various types. Machine learning, where AI system is able to learn from experience, leveraging statistical analytics and key algorithms. Deep learning takes it a step further, where they have developed electronic neural networks that replicate the way we think the human brain processes information. And even autonomous systems that integrate AI with various other emerging technologies like Internet of Things and 5G to provide systems that can perform such complex functions as self-driving cars or self-navigating drones or an intelligent procurement agent. Now, diagrammatically, I think it's important to get a feel for this because these are all types of AI. AI is not something that is fixed, it's a continuum. And some forms are relatively simple and straightforward and have been around for a while. Other forms of AI are extremely complex as you get into deep learning and generative AI. So if all of these things are AI, you have natural language processing and speech recognition, which are very closely related, and to a certain degree leverage machine learning capabilities. Robotic process automation, in some cases, can use some machine learning, but very often it is a little more discreet than that, but it's still considered a form of AI. And then, of course, machine learning, deep learning, an advanced form of that, and generative AI, like we get with tools like Google Bard and ChatGPT, is another application of deep learning technology. Autonomous systems that incorporate not only the AI, but pull in some of these other emerging technologies at the same time as you put the entire picture together. But it's important to understand this, because you need to realize that the notion that many people have had for years of, well, we're a do-it-yourself shop here. We like to build things for ourselves. We don't want to have to buy them from third-party vendors. Now, that idea has been slowly going away over the last generation, but it's still here a little bit. But it ain't going to work with AI. And the reason is that the resources needed are just too vast. So whether the private sector has the same issue to deal with for all practical purposes, you need to understand the importance of working with AI technology solution partners like many of the companies that are sponsors of this particular conference. And some of these companies in the consumer generative AI, We're talking about Google with their Bard solution, Microsoft's OpenAI's ChatGPT solution. There are several other products also out on the market currently. On the enterprise AI space, we've got Amazon Web Services Bedrock, Google's governmental AI, IBM's Watson X. Now, that's the latest version of IBM's software that has been around really for over a decade. How many people can remember when their earlier version of this product called Watson beat the human champions on Jeopardy about 10 years ago? Okay. And that was one of the first clues that most people had that AI was something more than just science fiction and the Terminator and robots slaughtering all the humans. And now they've come up with an advanced solution that integrates into these enterprise AI solutions, also the generative AI capabilities. But we also have Microsoft Azure's OpenAI, Oracle and their partnership with Cohere. All the major technology companies are incorporating AI functionality into solutions at the enterprise level. It's important to make the distinction, because it's at the enterprise level that we're talking about the kinds of things that enabled the scenario I described earlier with the intelligent procurement system. These are large-scale systems integrated in with your mission-critical business management systems and business processes. That's separate from individual consumers using AI tools, specifically generative AI tools like Google Bard and ChatGPT, to help them in doing their individual tasks, whether it's a personal task like writing out a wedding vows, for example, or whether it's a professional task like preparing a proposal for investment in technology, for example. But that's, in some cases, they can be integrated together, but it's important to understand that distinction and look at potential applications and use cases that address both of those ranges of capabilities. It's already being demonstrated that AI can improve performance of individuals, in this case specifically looking at generative AI tools. A study completed just this past month at the Boston Consulting Group that showed that consultants that used AI finished 12% more tasks on average, finished those tasks 25% faster, and produced 40% higher quality results than those students, consultants that were not using AI. And when they divided the consultants into the upper half of the most knowledgeable and experienced ones and the lower half and compared their performance before and after using AI, the people in the upper half, the most skilled and experienced consultants, improved their performance by 17%. Very substantial improvement. But the people in the lower half improved their performance by 43%. It raises the boat for everyone. In fact, using AI tools, the people previously in the lower half produced better results than the consultants that were in the upper half that weren't using AI tools. Now, at the end of the exercise, the people who had been in the upper half who were using AI were still producing better results than the people in the lower half using AI, but the gap was closed tremendously, which means you've got an increase in the productivity and quality of results across the board. In looking at tasks that could be impacted by generative AI tools, interestingly enough, it's those roles that require lower levels of experience, high school diploma or less, for things like pedicurists, fast food workers, security guards, and so forth, that have a relatively small portion of all the things that they do that are likely to be significantly impacted by AI. This is a study done just in the last couple of months by Cornell University. On the other hand, as you get up to those roles that require four-year degrees or graduate degrees, pharmacists, nurses, nuclear engineers, lawyers, now it can impact anywhere from 2/3 to 3/4 of the tasks that these people do can be dramatically affected and aided by generative AI. The question, of course, that we have to ask ourselves is this a good thing or a bad thing? And the answer, I think we can all agree, is yes. Depending, of course, on the people and the situation, the circumstances, the organization, and how you leverage these tools. Now, It's not just the end users, whether we're talking about first-line clerical and operational staff or senior executives, that can be aided by these tools, but it's the actual IT staff itself. Here's an example, for instance, of using generative AI to give commands in plain English for a system. In this case, we're going to build a little rocket ship game. And when you submit the commands, the system converts those into code. And ultimately, it's code that can be executed. So you say, well, take this picture of a rocket ship and put it on the page. Okay, make it smallish. Crop it circularly. And once you've done that, center it vertically on the stage and put it over to the left-hand side. And at each point in the process, as the command is submitted in English, the code is created that then executes. And now animate it and have it move horizontally left to right, bouncing off the walls of the page. Well, if you want to go to the link that you'll see in just a moment on the lower right-hand screen, you can watch the whole 8 or 9 minutes. And if you download this presentation from the virtual exhibits part of the website for the Digital Government Summit, you'll see all of the slides. And by the way, I'm only sharing about half of my slides with you today because of the time we have available. So you'll see a whole lot of additional information that's available to you out there. And you can watch the full 8 or 9 minute long demo that's been put up. But the best estimates are that this is going to increase the productivity of developers by 10 times. Now, when it comes to leveraging AI tools and their ability to create people's, dramatically increase productivity of people, again, whether we're talking about software developers, first-line clerical staffs, or even executives, the thought processes of the managers and senior executives who are confronted with this information tends to fall into two categories. There are the ones who I refer to as the short-sighted and stupid, who say, wow, we can fire 90% of our development staff now and still get just as little of the work done that we want to get done as we've been getting done for the past number of years. The ones who are foresighted and smart are the ones who say, we can let our entire development staff use these tools and increase by 5 or 10 times the amount of work that gets done, and we can start erasing our technical debt, catching up on our legacy systems modernization, doing a better and faster job of testing prototypes, leveraging various different kinds of emerging technologies to help us do a more cost-effective job of serving the needs of our constituents more effectively. Utah has been planning AI for some 5 years now. They are using natural language processing to do sentiment analysis of calls and social media posts, providing data for the governor's staff on various policy initiatives underway, using image recognition for new cattle brands. Because if a new cattle brand too closely resembles a previously existing cattle brand, that kind of defeats the purpose of having cattle branding to begin with. IoT sensors to analyze air quality, flagging suspicious applications for unemployment benefits, doing the connected vehicles kind of thing that we saw with our friend Doofus a few minutes ago. One of the exciting things that they're doing right now that Alan Fuller, the CIO, told me about in Utah just a couple of months ago, is that they're using Google Chronicle, which is a subset of the Google governmental AI suite of tools, and they're monitoring continuously all of the thousands and thousands of nodes on the entire statewide IT infrastructure for snippets of malware code that have somehow gotten into the infrastructure and are waiting there to be triggered and cause cyber threats of one kind or another. Now, how many programmers or cyber experts would you have to hire with both the expertise to recognize such malicious code and to be able to then remove it in order to do that? The answer in most cases is way more than you can afford. But with AI, now it can be done on a continuous basis, and it's been extremely beneficial for them. And they're using extensive use of robotic process automation to increase clerical staff productivity in areas like invoice processing, managing unemployment claims, IT help desk, and so forth. When we look at the usage of ChatGPT in another study done by Pew Research, it corresponds more to education level. And it also corresponds into another study I don't have a graph for, but I read recently, that shows that senior level executives, in general, 70 to 80% of them at least tried using one of these generative AI tools themselves. For middle level managers, it's been running around 50%. At least this was as of just a couple of months ago. But for first line employees, it runs at 15 or 20%. So guess which people are most scared about the potential of AI to remove them from their jobs? The first line employees, whose active support and participation you need in incorporating into projects and pilot tests to implement AI successfully, how enthusiastic do you think they're likely to be to make sure this test is a success? Because if it is, we're going to implement AI, and my reward is I'm going to be out on the street looking for a new job. Not very, if they don't understand that. The good news is that AI is not going to replace governmental decision makers, whether it's first line clerical staff or senior executives making strategic decisions. But the even better news is that it will enable decision makers at all levels to be innovative far beyond what we've been able to do before. So as we'll touch on in a few minutes, communications is absolutely critical to make sure that people understand these are tools to help them do their job better and spend more of their time doing the interesting, challenging parts of their job. All right? And how many times have you had an employee come up to you and leave, say, I'm sorry, I'm going to leave my job. I'm going out to take a job in the private sector because I'm just spending way too much of my time doing the interesting, challenging parts of my job. Not very often, thank goodness. So, how is it can be used specifically? Well, in the city of Amarillo, they've actually created a digital human avatar to do constituent support.
Navigating local government is often challenging for residents when they need access to information or services, particularly if that resident is not comfortable with technology or is new to our country and is still learning English. How much easier would it be if they could simply ask a question and get an answer? Digital humans enable new opportunities to greatly simplify the process for our residents. Let's start with a simple example of a resident needing to dispose of bulky trash.
Hello. Hola. Konnichiwa. I'm Sophie. It is great to meet you. What's your name?
Hi, Sophie. My name is Rich. I'm trying to find out if the city of Amarillo has a landfill.
Hello, Rich. Nice to meet you. Yes, the city of Amarillo does have a landfill. It is called the Amarillo Landfill, and it provides waste disposal services for residents and businesses in the area.
Is there anything they won't take?
While the Amarillo Landfill accepts a wide range of waste materials, there are certain items that may not be accepted for disposal. These can include hazardous materials such as chemicals, paints, batteries, and medical waste. It's always best to check with the landfill directly or visit their website for a comprehensive list of acceptable and prohibited items.
Can you repeat that in Spanish?
Of course. Here's the translation in Spanish. Aunque el relleno sanitario de Amarillo acepta una amplia gama de desechos, hay ciertos elementos que es posible que no sean aceptados para su disposición. Estos pueden incluir materiales peligrosos como productos químicos, pinturas, baterías y residuos médicos. Siempre es mejor consultar directamente con el relleno sanitario o visitar su sitio web para obtener una lista completa de los elementos aceptables y prohibidos.
And that's just one. And oh, by the way, Sophie is not a real person, an AI-generated avatar that happens to look like a nice and very smart young lady. Workforce management, always a challenge for government. And one of the most challenging areas is one they've dealt with at the Indiana Department of Child Services. where they were dealing with a problem that is endemic to state and local governments across the country. Child services caseworkers, annual turnover of 50%, because it is a very challenging and emotionally taxing job to have to do. So what they did was they developed a virtual reality simulation that prospective caseworkers, applicants for positions as caseworkers, could go through to get a better understanding of what was involved in that job so that they could self-select. And in many cases where they had said, well, this sounds like it would be a nice job, I guess I'd probably like to do that, and I've got the right qualifications, let me see. Then they get a real first-hand understanding and say, oh, wow, I couldn't deal with this. I think I better go find something else. Better then than after 6 months of training on their part. And on the other hand, they actually got more people self-selecting in. So that people say, oh, well, I wasn't quite sure if this is what I wanted. I certainly see it's challenging, but it's exactly the kind of thing I would love to do. This really appeals to me. Yes, I'm going to take this job. And apparently it's working because they've reduced their annual caseworker turnover in child services by 2/3 since they implemented this virtual reality simulation, from 50% a year to just 17% a year, among the best in the country. Governmental operations in Columbus, Ohio, they have Internet of Things monitoring traffic signals and adjusting timing of the traffic signals in real time, which has resulted in both reduced congestions, higher average speeds, still within the speed limit, but higher average speeds on the city streets, and improved safety in terms of reduced number of accidents taking place. And in the Lower Colorado River Authority, now this is not the Colorado River that actually starts in Colorado and runs through the Grand Canyon that we've all heard of. This is the Lower Colorado River in Texas that flows through Austin, Texas. But what they've done is put Internet of Things sensors into the feeder stream. So when they have a heavy period of rains and the levels in the feeder stream start rising, they can predict some hours or even a day or more ahead of time when they're going to have flooding and how much downstream, and take mitigating action ahead of time rather than after the fact. Similarly, over the last decade, the state of California has put over 1,000 wireless remote television cameras focused on heavily forested areas that are highly susceptible to wildfires. The problem, of course, is how many people do you have to hire to continuously monitor 1,000 television screens? How many television screens can one person monitor at a time? 5? 10? 20? Certainly no more than that. And that's assuming, of course, that they don't ever stop for lunch or take bathroom breaks. Instead, now, over the last couple of years, what they've done is they've implemented AI image recognition technology so that when something comes up that appears that it could be a wildfire, it immediately notifies a qualified person who comes over and takes a look at it and says, oh, wow, I can see exactly why that looks like a wildfire, but I'm also aware there's a big construction project going on in that area. It's been very dry. It's kicking up a lot of dust, and it's that dust that looks like smoke. I think we're fine there. Or is this flames coming up over here? Let's take a look. No, there's just a heavy amount of traffic in that particular area, and it's a bright sunny day, and the angle of the sun is glinting off of a lot of the windshields of those vehicles as they're passing through. We're good. Here's another one over there. Ah, wow, that is a wildfire. Let's get some first responders out there immediately to get it under control before it gets out of control. And as a result, they have succeeded in doing that in many cases by having first responders on site putting out the fires before it was ever called into 911 by even a single resident or other person passing through. And it's been a very successful program for them. Now, we're going to give you guys an opportunity to get hands-on with generative AI. Now, I know a lot of you already have, but let's find out. How many people here, and first of all, let's bring up the instructions. So if you haven't done this already, log on either to Google Bard or to ChatGPT, or in the case of ChatGPT, you could download from the App Store the ChatGPT app. So get ready to do that. Get your phones out. We're going to put them in use here. All right? And while you guys are getting set up and logged in, and we're going to see who's logged in, but before we do that, let me ask you, how many people here have ever used either Google Bard or ChatGPT? Raise your hands. Okay, it looks to me like it's about two-thirds of you. So for the other third of you, today is your first opportunity to do it. I encourage you to do it. Now, some of you may say, as many people have said to me over the last year or so, do I really need to learn how to, I mean, this AI stuff, it sounds interesting, but I'm not a technology professional or a computer programmer. Am I going to really need to learn how to use this stuff? And every time I hear that question, I think, wait, I'm hearing an echo from 25 years ago. It's 1998. Hey, Jack, I'm not an IT professional or a computer programmer. This internet stuff sounds very interesting. But am I going to really need to ever learn how to use this stuff? I mean, like, am I going to have to get one of those email address things? Well, the answer is maybe not today and maybe not tomorrow, but soon and for the rest of your life. So, of those of you that have ever used it, how many use it on an occasional ongoing basis? Let's say a couple of times a month. Raise your hands if you use one of these. Okay, not quite so many, maybe 40% up here, 35, 40%. How many of you use it regularly, several times a week? Let me see your hands. All right, well, that's a good turnout. That's probably a quarter of you. How many use it frequently enough that you're paying $20 a month out of your own pocket for a ChatGPT subscription? Let's see, we've got one, two, let's see, I think that's all I end up with. Well, that's a small number, but it's not much smaller than we've seen at most of the other events I've spoken at around the country over the course of the last year. So you're going to get a chance to play with it today. And here is the first command I want you to put in. Raise your hand if you have now got either ChatGPT or Google Bard up on your personal device. Okay, good. So here's the first command. What are the best sites for out-of-town visitors to see in my locale? Now, your locale is not the state of Michigan or Greater Lansing, but it is whatever specific town or village, or if you happen to live in the city of Lansing or another major city neighborhood that you live in. Okay, so while you're putting that command in and getting your answers back, since the meeting is taking place here in Lansing, I went ahead and asked what the top sites were to see in Lansing. And this is what I got when I asked Google Bard about this. It said, well, there's the Michigan State Capitol Building, of course, right up the street. You all are familiar with that. Michigan History Center, Potter Park Zoo, the Olds Transportation Museum, Oldstown Lansing, which I had a chance to ride through last night. A lot of fun, very interesting area. So, who's got a response for their particular town? Anybody? Yes, ma'am, over here. What is your residence area?
East Lansing.
East Lansing. And what are the top two or three things that one should visit in East Lansing?
Michigan State University, Spartan Stadium, and the Eli and Edith Broad Art Museum.
Okay. And the gentleman next to you is had his hand up. What's your locale?
Mine is Charlotte, Michigan.
And what was one want to see when visiting Charlotte?
Not as many.
And by the way, are you using Google Bard or ChatGPT?
ChatGPT.
Chat in this case. Okay,
yes.
Go ahead.
All right. The Courthouse Square, the Eaton County Fairgrounds, and of course the world famous Hayes Green Beach Memorial Hospital seems to be an option to visit.
All right. I hope you're visiting it as a visitor and not as a patient. So thank you. So who else has got an interesting response? Gentleman over here with the suit. And the short haircut, thank you so much. And what's your neighborhood or locale?
Short haircut, that's generous. I did Detroit. It came up with 20 hits.
Oh.
But interesting, the number two hit is the Henry Ford in Dearborn.
Which is technically not in Detroit.
Correct.
Okay, so you get a little bit of a stretch of boundaries in this particular case. Good point. There were a couple of other hands over this way. This gentleman here, sir. What's your area?
So I chose a town in the Upper Peninsula called Curtis, Michigan.
Okay.
And it was spot on. Tequamanon Falls, Whitefish Point, Big Springs, etc.
All right, great. Now, did anybody get an answer that was something that you should see in your town that either doesn't exist as far as you know or exists in some place that's actually far away from you? Okay, and what did you get, Jackie, if you would, this lady over here right in front? And where what is your locale that you used?
I put Kalkaska, Michigan, is where I was
born. Okay, Southampton, Michigan?
Kalkaska.
Okay, go ahead.
One of the options is Lambertson's Antique and Gift Shop, which has been closed for 10 years.
I see. Okay, so you'd be disappointed in trying to visit Lambertson's Antique and Gift Shop. And do we have one more? All right, so first, please tell us what your locale is you were asking about.
Parma, Michigan.
Okay, and what would one find there that was exciting and fun?
Well, it came up with Hidden Lake Gardens in MIS, and that's quite a hike from Parma.
Okay, all right. One presumes there's other things in Parma that are superior to see that you don't have to drive so far to get to. Well, one of the challenges with generative AI tools is that they are still not yet quite accurate. And they're getting way, way smarter. They're way far more accurate now than they were even 6 or 8 months ago. But they still make mistakes, in part because they are based on having reviewed most all of the information on the internet, on Wikipedia and sources like this. And did you know there's information on the internet that is wrong? In fact, there are some people that actually intentionally put wrong information on the internet, but that's a whole other conversation. But the point being that, so sometimes you will get a mistaken answer, and so you do have to use a certain amount of common sense when you use these tools. The analogy, a couple analogies I like to make is one, if you stop and think about using a calculator, okay? And let me ask this gentleman sitting right here in the front row, very quickly off the top of your head, what's 17 times 63? Haven't got a clue. And who else would? That's what we have calculators for, right? Right? So suppose that I gave you a calculator and said, figure out 17 times 63, and what would you think if the answer came up and said 6,423,000?
Probably wrong.
Probably wrong. Right. Correct. Probably wrong. Because common sense tells us, well, I'm not sure what 17 times 63 is, or care all that much, but I know for sure it's not 6.5 million. Let me rekey it and do it right. But what happens if you give an 8-year-old, who that by that time has learned the concepts of addition and subtraction and multiplication, and you give them a calculator, and they put in 17 times 63, and it comes up and says 6 million, they're going to say, well, that's what the calculator is for, to give me the right answer. That must be the answer. Write it down. That's why you don't give calculators to 8-year-olds, at least without supervising them correctly. And the same thing holds true. You've got to supervise yourself, and you've got to supervise the tool. Use common sense. Use the smell test. Think of it a little bit, too. They can do what are called hallucinations. They can make stuff up. So it's a little bit like having a junior intern assistant that thinks 1,000 times faster than any person you've ever met in your life, knows 1,000,000 times more than anybody you've ever met in your life, and 90, 95, 98% of the time is going to give you brilliant and creative solutions to problems, but every now and then is so eager to please you that if it can't find the right answer to a problem, it'll just make something up that sounds good. So, again, you need to keep the eyes out for using these kinds of things. Now, moving closer to actual governmental applications of the technology, here's the next prompt I'd like you to put in to your generative AI tool in your hand. How do I renew my driver's license? 6 words. Seven words. How do I renew my driver's license? Now, while you're doing that, let me share with you what I put in and the response I got. In this case, I switched from Google Bard over to ChatGPT. And it said, certainly, the process, here are a general overview, check expiration date, determine eligibility, gather necessary documents, and so forth, as you can see on the screen. Now, has anybody else here got a response yet on how to renew a driver's license? Hold up your hand if you can
tell us.
Okay, we've got somebody. Jackie has spotted. All right, thank you, ma'am. What does it say?
Well, I thought it was interesting that it said there are 3 ways to renew your driver's license in Michigan. So it automatically knew that I was in Michigan, and then it gave me online, by mail, or in person.
So let me ask you, which tool are you using? I'm going to guess you're using Google Bard, but I couldn't.
Correct.
Okay. Because Google Bard is able to track that you are in Michigan, okay, and you've already been interacting with it. ChatGPT, the free version that almost everybody here is using, doesn't do that yet. That's about to change in the next few weeks. But for the moment, it doesn't do that. So when I did it with ChatGPT, it also says, to provide accurate information, could you please specify the country or state that you're in? So the follow-up would be, can I do it online in Michigan in this case? Now, and the answer that I got was, yes, you can. Now here's how, and you can go ahead and enter the, in fact, if you enter the command, can I do it online in Michigan? Because you've already been asking it about renewing your driver's license, it's like having a conversation with a person. It remembers that's the topic at hand. If you started a new chat or a new thread, and then just started from scratch, can I do it online in Michigan? Probably the first response would be, do what? But in the case of this, it knows. So you can have a continuous thread that goes on, so you can have an ongoing interaction like a conversation. Now, has anybody else gotten an interesting response from inquiring about doing it online in Michigan yet? Receiving a renewing your driver's license? Yes, there's a gentleman over here, Jackie, with a red shirt.
I'm coming. I get an extra drink tonight after all this running.
All right.
Yeah, I'm using Bard, so I did the initial prompt, and instead of, I just put in what URL, and it spit out the URL for Michigan Secretary of State.
All right, great, excellent. Sent out the URL for the Michigan Secretary of State. Now, in the case of ChatGPT, I was using the paid version of ChatGPT, and if you look at the top of the screen, it says something called Used Browser Pilot. Browser Pilot is one of about 150 plugins that are available currently for ChatGPT. And we're gonna see all the tools, Google Bard and the others, they'll all be using plugins, they'll all be vetted and working better and so forth. In this particular case, it's one that also allows you to browse the web because, as I said, the base version of ChatGPT does not do that yet. And so similarly, it gave us a link to the Michigan Department of State up the page about how do I renew my driver's license or my ID. So we're gonna see more and more of these tools becoming available. And in this particular case, if I pop the little carrot open on Browser Pilot, it actually will show me the interaction, the communications between the plugin and ChatGPT, which starts off with comments like, use the same language that the user has requested or has been using. So if the person is making the request in Spanish or Japanese or Hindi, then it's saying respond back to it in the same language unless they make a specific request to use something different than that. Okay, here's one of the prompts I'd like you to enter in and see what kind of response you get. Begin the prompt with the words, act as if. And then continue. You're the director of communications for the State Department of Motor Vehicles. How would you explain this simply, and why would you say it this way? So you can take a look at that while you're keying in this prompt. I know it's a little bit longer, but a couple of important comments I have to share with you. Act as if, regardless of what tool you're using, is an extremely powerful tool because it says, if you want to say, act as if you were a world-leading expert consultant in this particular field or specialty. Well, the first thing it does is it looks out at its entire corpus of knowledge and says, what do people who are world-class leading consultants in this area of specialty know? What do they understand? How do they approach the problems that they solve? And then it responds to the next part of the request, how would you explain this simply? Because somebody who was the director of communications might explain it in a slightly different way than somebody who was perhaps not quite as knowledgeable or experienced in communicating clearly and simply various different complex topics. But also important is, why would you say it this way? Now, how many people remember essay tests in high school or college? All right? And wasn't the worst part? The worst part wasn't when they said, for example, well, describe the history of the Crimean War, okay? But when they would say, explain what happened in the history of the Crimean War and why. Every time the teacher would put and why, it said, oh my gosh, I can't just recite, memorize facts. I have to actually explain something in a way that conveys that I really understand what the heck I'm talking about. So it's a great way to ask questions of these tools. Say, and why? So in this particular case, you can look at what kind of answers you've gotten, but here we've got a response that came up for when I did this. Dear Michigan residents, good news, renewing your driver's license has never been easier. Blah, 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 you can do it online. Why online? Convenience, efficiency, safety, quick steps, and so forth. And then going on to the why. By framing the information this way, I'm aiming to emphasize convenience, explain the cost, offer alternatives, and to provide support. This approach is designed to build trust, enhance understanding, and promote a positive experience with the DMV. And we all need positive experiences with the DMV. So this is part of the reason why you want to be able to use the tool and ask the question, why, when you do this. Now, this last example is one you can go ahead and put your mobile devices away at this point. But this is homework for you to do, whether it's tonight, this weekend, whenever you have a few minutes free. Create a post to hire a digital transformation leader for your governmental agency, whatever that might be, at the state or local level. But there's something else important. Again, how many people here have ever been involved in the hiring process? Have hired people, have been participating in the hiring? Okay, most of you have, of course. All right. So I'm sure working in government, you've probably many times had this situation come up where a very well-qualified person applies for the job, and then you get back to them, well, what do you think? Well, I'm sorry, I've decided to take a job in the private sector. Oh, why is that? Well, it's about the salary. Well, what about the salary? Well, the thing is, you guys in government are offering so much more than the private sector is that I would just be embarrassed to tell my friends how much more I'm making than that. This is not a problem you have on a regular basis in the government. People don't go to work for the government because that's where the big bucks are. There's other incentives that are more valuable to, in most people's minds, than just having the biggest number of zeros on your salary. So you might go on and say, acknowledge that your agency may not match salaries available in the private sector, but make the post enticing to them anyway. What are the good reasons why you would want to take a job working for the government, even if you might not make quite as much money as you could perhaps elsewhere? So anyway, here's a few examples of how generative AI can be used in many different parts of your organization. There are hundreds. Take a picture of this. Even more valuable, download the slides later from the virtual exhibit area. But everything from assisting to recruitment, as we've talked about, to process optimization and in operations, to legal research, to financial report generation, all areas. And there are literally hundreds of other possibilities for applications of these technologies in state and local government. So let me summarize a few key things, and then hopefully we may have a minute or two for Q&A. I'll leave that up to Jackie. But it's about your workforce and your constituents. And technology is a tool to help you serve both better. So don't just think about automating your existing processes. Think outside the box about how these new technologies can enable new approaches. Don't just look for the 10% marginal improvement. Look for how you can do it 10 times better or faster or more cost effectively than you were able to do it before. And think long term. It's not about what quick win can we get in the next 90 days. It's about where do we want to be 3 to 5 years from now as these different technologies come to various degrees of maturity. That means you need to build flexible plans because the impact of strategic disruptions like climate change, like pandemics, like global supply disruptions because of a war in Ukraine or elsewhere are always going to upset the apple cart on some of your short-term plans. Rather than just throw out your goals, make sure that you're flexible enough and that you have various different ways that you can achieve those goals. So if one approach is disrupted, you can shift to a different approach that will still work. That's key change management strategy. And as important as technology implementation is, and it is very important, change management is even more important. And there's three keys to successful change management with digital transformation. One, education first of your management, not just the management of the IT organization, more importantly, the management and the senior executives of your agencies, and bureaus and so forth, and of the legislative branch. Two, education of your workforce, especially your non-technical workforce, so that they understand that these are tools that are designed to help them do their jobs better and more productively and spend more time on the fun, interesting, and challenging parts of their jobs. And finally, who wants to guess what number three is? Education, right. In this case, of your constituents. Help them better understand how you are using and are planning to use these exciting emerging technologies to do a better job of serving their needs more cost effectively, so you're also doing a better job of spending their tax dollars. But at the same time, I also encourage state and local governments to work closely with your private sector constituents in educating them about the displacements that will be taking place. A lot of people are scared to death about how many jobs is AI going to replace. Best estimates are that over the course of the next 10 to 15 years, we will see at least a 30% increase in the number of jobs that are available to people because of AI and related emerging technologies. But many of those will be different jobs from the ones that are being done today. Okay? We don't have a lot of buggy whip manufacturers around Michigan anymore, even though 100 years ago that was, well, maybe 120, that was still a big part of the automotive business or the pre-automotive business. The point being that there is going to be displacement. People are going to, in some cases, have to either learn new skills to keep their jobs or going to think about shifting into new kinds of jobs that will be created. And it's the public-private partnerships, in my opinion, that will be most successful in helping your constituents and your residents make those transitions. All of this is a lot of change, but as the famed historian Henry Steele Commager put so well over a century ago, while change does not necessarily assure progress, progress implacably requires change. I hope you will make the changes in your organizations, your systems, your processes, and most of all, your own mindsets to ensure that your organizations and yourselves personally not only survive, but thrive in the exciting years that lie ahead. And if I can be of any help to you in doing that, please reach out to me. It would absolutely be my pleasure. Thank you so much for listening this afternoon. Thank you.